our management learners. So thank you so, so much for, you know, being here. And I'm really interested to hear about your story on, really, I want to hear all of it. And I want to hear, starting with, okay, so now today,
yes,
we're going to go backwards to go forwards. But we met when you were transitioning out of the Canadian Armed Forces into your entrepreneurial endeavor. So yes. I want to hear first a bit about what brought you into the Canadian Armed Forces and what kind of roles and journeys kind of brought you to when we met in June.
Okay. So I will have to go back where I was a kid. So I was born and raised in Montreal. So from an immigrant family that immigrated from Haiti. So at that time, growing up, we didn't have much. We didn't know anything about how to handle money and finances and things like that. So money and finance was a taboo subject. We never really talked about it, but hey, we were living good. We're scraping by. You know, I used to be like sleep on floors at my cousin's place because, you know, they were living in tiny apartments. But hey, man, it was family, right? And we had that sense of community, and we stuck together through the what we call the hardship, right? So fast forward, I was going through school and everything started working. So I was always broke because I was trying to, you know, impress people, like dress a certain way to say, hey, man, you have to be rich to show that you have money. And I accumulated so much debt as a student. Credit cards, it was easy. Just apply and you get some money and you pay. Essentially, I never paid it back. So now I'm out of school, 25. So 25, married, a kid on the way. I have an unimaginable amount of debt, student debt, plus no cash, no investment, and zero knowledge about how to handle my money. So what ended up happening, my wife joined the military first because her brother was serving. And I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. It's not for me. And then she did it anyway. And when she came back from her basic training, I'm like, you know what, if we were to move, I will have to find something. You know, there's no way out, and I joined the military and see if I could find a place. And I didn't like it at first, but then after working, going through basic training and training, and finding that sense of brotherhood, teamwork, and team cohesion, one team, one goal, it really was appealing to me. And through all of that, I was starting to learn about investing, how to manage money, because I was paying off my debt, be more responsible in a sense. And I'm like, man, I'm getting really good at it. So I was trying to find a way to say, hey, why not get paid for it? And basically was the start of my entire entrepreneurship journey, which we fast forward 13 years later, which is today. And there was that Princess Trust that was part of the, for the veterans that I applied for. And I say, hey, I want to start a business in the financial industry. I'm already licensed, and I see how can I do this? Who can I meet to make this work? And through that, because at that point, I was saying, hey, I want to retire from the military. I want to do this as a business and really help the community learn about money and finance and help them invest for their future and whatnot. So through that experience at Princess Trust, it really opened my eyes and see, hey, man, you really need a solid foundation and a team behind you to make this work. You can't do this alone. So, yeah.
Thank you. It's one thing that you said there that I really want to point out is that you started kind of with like a problem, in the yep. sense that you found yourself, you know, with the debt at 25, baby on the way, married, and then you were You joined the armed forces and you saw, oh crap, how am I going to pay this back? So you empowered yourself while working to mm-hmm. learn. And I love what you said here. You said, I got good and then I figured out how to get paid for it. Yeah. And I think sometimes we have it backwards. We want to get paid for it and then we think that we'll get good at it. So I really like your order of operations. You know, build a skill set, find a problem, find something that is either a pain point for you, a pain point for others, something that you care deeply about, and learn and learn and learn. And then there will be a way in which you can turn that into something that you get paid for. And so that's another reason why, you know, what do we say? It's like, you know, put up and shut up, right? Just get right? going, get after it. So.
and I'm sure it might have been the same way for you going through through school and I say, hey, I want to be a professional. How can I do this? You probably did a lot of sacrifice too to get where you're at today, right?
Yeah. I will say that it you know, being there's also a lot of dumb luck with it. So I always love to look back and be like, okay, what was something that, you know, either was done by accident or done on purpose, and what was the result mm-hmm. and what can I learn from it? So I can ensure that I can increase the chances of like doing that on purpose and having another good reaction versus just kind of like bobbling along. So yeah, if I could go back to my younger self, you know, 15, 20 years ago, and kind of say, hey, listen, get good, then get paid, like get good and focus on like, how can I get better? How can I get better? I would love to have heard that because, you know, I tended to look for markers of success, you know, whether it's financial or a job title or this or that, by something that somebody was going to give me versus something that I was going to go out and earn myself. And I think it's such a small nuance, but it's something that's so important because it's like, we can focus on our effort. We can focus on getting better and good, and then the outputs will follow, versus if you're trying to make the end the goal, you know, when you get there, you're kind of like, oh crap, now I got to get good because now I'm here. So I love that you're laughing because possibly, let me know if I'm right or wrong. Before we got on here, you and I were talking about how it really is the journey and it's not the destination.
Exactly. It is the journey. Because we always been taught that, you know, have a goal. I'm like, yeah, this is the end result. But at some point in time, you never get there because they say, what's next? What's next? So, you know, it's always changing. We're always adapting and evolving. So we have to enjoy the journey. It is all about that when we talk about success. But more so is doing things on purpose and according to your values. That's extremely important.
Yeah. And the good thing is if you live and, you know, go by your values, you're often attracting other people that have similar values or values that align, and you can kind of build your team that way. So one thing that you mentioned is building your team and filling in the gaps. Now, looking at the group as a collective and learning about the different businesses that the different entrepreneurs in the Prince's Trust Operation Entrepreneur, there was, you know, a woman who's a bookkeeper and studying to do bookkeeping. There are people that are doing leisure activities, people that are involved in the electric car business servicing, people that are doing, you know, building houses, people that are taking down trees. So even within that ecosystem, you know, I see like there's a financial advisor, there's a bookkeeper, like there's a team that's going to be coming around together. How important, or, you know, can you share a bit about what it was like going through with a cohort and, you know, whether or not, I would just like to hear a little bit about that, the cohort, and kind of, from the inside, things that maybe I didn't get an opportunity to see.
thank you for letting me sharing this, to see the passion in what people wanted to accomplish, it was that level of sometimes uncertainty. Some of them like, oh, am I good enough to actually do this? Because they have a plan. they don't know how to get there or who to talk to. So, but hence the reason why we all joined that program. We don't really know what we're doing until actually doing it. But we were looking for some sort of guidance. So talking with all of us, but we had that same way of teamwork. We wanted to have people that are better than us by filling the gap. And with that, we bonded on the fact that we're all in the military. So we know what it takes to accomplish a mission. It's always the mission, the mission first, and we will get there by any means necessary. So they have that, those projects at heart, and they understand the value of talking to people and really bonding on a deeper level. And we even sometimes shared about our traumas, which really reinforced our bond. And it was only for a week that we attended there, but now we created what we call referrals. So, hey, you have a gardener, you have a bookkeeper, say, you know someone that you could connect to and say, hey, let me give some so-and-so a call. So that was the kind of the background experience that you didn't really saw, Samantha, but it was that sense of belonging, you know. We will get there eventually.
We'll get there eventually. And I love the referrals, because when somebody asks you for a referral, or you see somebody that needs a referral, what you are doing when you give a referral is you are putting your reputation out there, and you're saying, this person will take care of you like I would take care of you. So you said, you have that common bond, you are lifting each other up. Absolutely. That is the strongest referral, to be like, hey, they got you, like, you know, and being able to kind of lift each other up. And that is a skill set on its own of collaboration that I think our management learners can really pick up on, whether you're in a class, you're all in a class for a reason, like you have a shared bond. And then when you leave that class, you have the opportunity to continue that shared bond and, you know, leverage each other. I always joke that the people that I want on my team are the ones that, you know, will, you know, be in a meeting, be freaked out, go to the bathroom and text me on the toilet, right? same here. Like, that's what I want on my team. So we have our team by circumstance, and then we have our team that we can build. And it's I got you. I want that. And it's just so empowering, because if we want to feel good and, you know, make an impact and, you know, achieve our goals and lift everybody else up, there's going to be some scary points, and that's okay, because it's not all on you. It's all on our team. It's helping each other. So I love, I suspected that it was possibly like that behind the scenes, but I'm really happy to kind of confirm that.
And one thing I want to mention is do it anyway. That's one of my motto. Do it anyway. Just, even though you're scared, just do it. What's the worst that could happen, right?